thousands of Atlantic salmon that escaped from a fish farm to the east of Victoria into the open waters of Puget Sound, the Pacific Ocean. And this escape is raising plenty of concerns about impact on ecosystem and economy.
On August 19th, 2017, a net pen holding over 300,000 Atlantic salmon collapsed into the Salish Sea. This was a catastrophic event caused by failure to do essential maintenance on the pen. The company at fault, Cook Aquaculture, misled state officials about the seriousness, cause, and number of fish that were held in the pen. As Atlantic salmon are invasive fish in the Pacific Ocean, this was a large-scale problem for the future of native salmon. To talk about why native salmon are important in Washington State, we went to talk with Pepper Hambrick, the program coordinator at the Friends of Issaquah Salmon Hatchery.
They've been a major food source for Native Americans ever since the beginning. So as you can imagine, they're a great source of protein and good fat. And so there's a lot of culture and art around salmon. That, of course, continued when European settlers arrived here and noticed that they're a great source of food, also commerce. So an industry rose up around catching and canning and selling salmon to the rest of the world. On top of that, salmon provide nutrients for, I think it's 137 other species in the area. So they're what we call a keystone species. If you remove salmon from the equation, that's hundreds of other animals that are going to be hurt. Not just animals, but plants.
Salmon play an important role in the ecosystem of the region. They return nutrients to the rivers and streams where they were born. In doing so, they feed the wildlife and forests with their bodies. For thousands of years, salmon have shaped the lives of people who have lived in the Pacific Northwest since the beginning. The religion of the Pacific Northwest tribes were all impacted and influenced by salmon. Salmon have been an important part of the economy of the region for thousands of years, from the ancient Indian trade to commercial fishing. Overall, salmon have been the symbol and lifeblood of the people who call the Pacific Northwest home. The Atlantic salmon escape back in August was not the first time, because of human error, native salmon have been put at risk. But this time, it may be one of the most damaging because of the already declining health of salmon habitats. We asked Pepper about some potential effects the recent escape could have on salmon right now and in the future.
Some of the things that a mass influx of a non-native species like this, some of the things that concern us about that, one is competition for resources. If we have several species of native Pacific salmon, and if they use the same habitat or eat the same food as these non-native Atlantic salmon, then of course there's fewer resources for the salmon that we want to preserve. Another concern is that a lot of people have is crossbreeding, so interbreeding between the species. I only bring that up because it's something that people ask about a lot. As far as we know, breeding between different species of salmon is extremely unlikely. It's not the sort of thing that's generally going to happen in the wild. They're not really compatible. But another major concern is what type of parasites or diseases a non-native species might bring with it.
In addition, according to Mike Villings, a founder and managing partner of AquaSpark, an environmentally and socially sustainable aquaculture enterprise, Other concerns involving badly managed aquaculture fisheries include waste or effluent following from fish farms, damage to native species habitats due to waste and other chemical antibiotic treatments stemming from efforts at disease prevention, and unsustainable feed ingredients, which consist of 30 million tons of small fish, usually sardines and anchovies, to create fish meal for feed. Stanford University said that if 50% of these fish are left in the ocean, then the oceans would be saved. The fact is that 65% of fisheries have unsustainable practices. They are destroying the oceans. They have the worst slavery issues, especially in Thailand and Asia. They spread disease to native and juvenile fish. They use chemicals for disease prevention and are damaging to the marine life and are a source of pollution. And escaped fish compete for food and reduce the food supply for native species. This throws off the food chain. Baby, there's a hole in my heart tonight. Maybe you could be my lifeline. All aboard this lonely, lonely ride. Driving with one headlight. You can stop, but we can't rewind. So in the Squally tribe, you're sitting on the reservation right now in the tribal admin building. Our tribal boundaries are... they're not very, very big anymore, because in 1917, Fort Lewis and JBLM came in and condemned 2/3 of our reservation. But our people roam Mount Rainier, the Cascade, the mountain range, all the way, you know, down to the ocean. You know, our Nisqually people were from there, here to there. We say that without our salmon, you know, we lose our identity as Native people. Because it's not about making money for us when we go out fishing. It's about being able to do what our ancestors did, it's different backgrounds, church, whatever it may be. But for us, being on that river is church. That's medicine for us. And you know, when people ask me this question, it's our culture and our salmon. You know, that's who we are. That's the foundation of who we are as Nisqually people. Without that, you know, I feel like we lose our identity. Global meat consumption has quadrupled. By 2050, we are predicted to need 70% more protein than needed today. As 2.6 billion people depend on the ocean for their protein, fish farms or aquaculture is needed. Fisheries alleviate pressure on the ocean and produce the fish that is growing in demand.
How could we let, you know, almost 500,000 salmon into the Puget Sound from the cook industry? I mean, that should never happen. And, you know, the Puget Sound is dying right now. Whether it's pollution, whether it's runoff, whether it's Atlantic salmon spill into the water, whether it's oil, whatever it might be. You know, so we have another organization that my dad started in 2004, and that's Salmon Defense. And we educate, advocate, and litigate. And that's young people involved in. You know, whether it's picking up garbage on the side of the road, people ask me that question, well, how can I get involved? And that's what I tell them. I said, like, if you see garbage by the streams or the rivers, pick it up.
We're here at a local river to help do our part in protecting the salmon, so we're going to go around and collect some trash.
Although picking up trash is such a simple act that anyone can do, this action directly helps salmon and the health of many bodies of water. Here are three ways that trash affects the environment. First, it upsets the food chain because it comes in sizes large and small. Pollution even affects the world's tiniest organisms such as plankton. This can cause a whole slew of problems, each step further along the food chain. Plus, it means that toxins are present in the fish that many people eat every day. Secondly, the world's water is in great danger because of leaking pollution and waste. Groundwater and reservoirs are susceptible to leaking environmental toxins. This has had terrible effect on many marine species, which can lead to consequences for those that eat fish and marine life for nutrients, including people. Finally, it kills animals. Despite countless TV ads over the years showing ducks or dolphins trapped in six-ring plastic can holders, these items are still used and discarded in mass each day. Whether it is because the massive litter and trash has displaced animals or the related toxins have poisoned them, pollution does a lot of damage to the world's ecosystems. But as the damaging factors to the health of the environment that come along with aquaculture, we present some solutions. Future aquaculture companies should be required to, 1, have healthier feed such as microbes, insects, seaweed, and microalgae. 2, be more water efficient. 3, use controlled environments such as land-based recirculation farms to mitigate disease and lower the use of antibiotics and chemicals. 4, have automatic feeders that sense when fish are hungry, which saves on feed and creates less pollution. And 5, have data systems to improve farm practices. Aquaculture is a young industry with lots of room for innovation and improvement. As far as the Puget Sound is concerned, we agree with Willie Frank.
I'm happy with the bill that passed. I'm happy that they took action on it, but I wish it would have been immediately they did more. I thought there could have been a faster time frame on it because, you know, 7 years is a long time. A lot can happen in 7 years.
Something you can do on a daily basis is ask questions. The information should be readily available. Ask where your fish came from, who raised it, and what did it eat. Show you care about what you consume. Eventually, restaurants will listen and we will all benefit.
Won't you wait? Won't you stay? At least until the sun goes down. When you're gone, I lose faith. I lose everything I have found. Heartstrings. That's what I hear when you're by my side. Yeah, that's what I hear when